Hi everyone, this is Manmohan here. I have with me Anuj, and we are yet back again to talk to you guys about some of the questions you had on POCO. So let's begin. Anuj, the first question is from Manas. Why POCO has been separated from Xiaomi and it has become an independent brand? What is the reason behind it?
Okay. Well, there are obviously a lot of reasons, and you can, you were the one who got that whole thing started. But of course, the whole idea is POCO is a very different philosophy, and to kind of, you know, get that philosophy out, to be able to completely pursue that across price bands, to be able to do what you want to do, where you want to sell, who you want to sell to, that was the independence that we were looking at, just independent, operating separately.
Maybe just to add to it, right? I mean, maybe I'll just take 2 minutes explaining this journey. When POCO was created within Xiaomi, it was just an entrepreneurial team with just an idea that we could do something different. That idea formulated in the form of POCO F1, and POCO F1 saw a huge, huge success. So given the success of POCO F1, we took, of course, our time to understand this industry and how the business has to be run. Once we were clear on each and XYZ of the business model, we said that, okay, now it's time for us to act independently, so that we can take the decisions faster, be agile as a startup, and to ensure we are able to deliver the promise which we always offer to, which is everything you need, nothing you don't. So that was the idea. Of course, we also are still leveraging some of the benefits of the overall Xiaomi ecosystem, but as the product decisions, we are making independent choices and we are trying to deliver on the promises that we have mentioned to you before.
Yeah.
The next question is from Shreyas Raj. I'm about to buy X3, but many reviewers have issues with the security app, having permissions to location and other stuff. What's your point of view on this?
A fair question. At the outset, I would say you have a choice not to use it at all, right? So you have a choice not to use any of the apps here. The security app, as the name suggests, is an integral app into the UI. It has various functions, and that's where some of the permissions come in. So we've obviously, as time has gone, we have cut down the number of permissions it needs, but some permissions it'll still require. The main set of permissions that come are from the virus scanning and the file cleaner app, or the segment inside that app. And that is required because you need to go deep into the system. For example, if you're cleaning a virus, then you cannot have antivirus with no access. And you also can't change those permissions, because if a virus comes and can actually play around with these permissions, then it can actually switch off the access and your antivirus will never get to know. And that's where it's important. Same with file cleaner. Now, what happens is, when it has system access or cleaning properties like this, from an Android perspective itself, it's locked. So that's why it's, you're not allowed to change those. A couple of other permissions that it asks is call logs, your phone state, and your contact list. And that's largely for blocking spam callers, or basically blacklisting numbers, and vice versa, from a contact list, whitelisting numbers. None of that data actually matters to anything outside that phone, right? So it's only on your phone. So you don't really have to worry about the security part of it. These are all permissions required for a very specific function. But like I said, you can just choose to ignore the entire app itself.
Specifically on location, Anuj, I don't think we are now asking those permissions anymore, right?
Location, calendar, things that didn't really make sense or were not required for these core functions,
they have been turned off.
If you've not got that update, just go take a look at it and see if you've got that. App update.
Of course. Now to the next question. Ankush is asking this. Hi sir, very huge fan of POCO. I recently bought POCO M2, but still waiting for MIUI 12. My question is, when will POCO offline store open? And next one is, when will POCO UI launch? I think there are three questions. MIUI 12 for POCO M2 first to begin with.
Okay. So, I think we've pretty much covered all the other POCO phones. So M2 is the only one that's left, and obviously we are working on this. In the next couple of months, it will definitely be coming in.
Okay.
But we've now rolled out MIUI 12. I mean, the C3 comes with it. Your M2 Pro has got it. F1 has got it from 2018. I mean, F1 is absolutely amazing, right? Because it started off with MIUI 9 and we are at 12 now. And even the X2 and the X3 have received MIUI 12.
Yeah. And again, POCO offline strategy.
No plans right now. We want to focus on the products right now. We don't want to focus on developing a new channel. We don't really have the team or the resources to be able to do that right now.
Right. And similar answer for probably POCO UI?
Yeah.
Coming to the next question, Pratik Verma. Can we expect a massive upgrade in the mid-range segment in the charging speed or a 108 MP camera things? By the way, I appreciate the implementation of a huge 6000 mAh battery next week. Wow.
Yeah.
First of all, thanks for that, this implementation.
Yeah, I mean, 6000 obviously, you know, I do most of my work on the phone right
True.
Now. And it's always connected. And sometimes it's really surprising because at the end of the day, at about 10:30, you know, when I'm finally putting that phone down, I look at it and it's still at 65%. I'm like, you know, what do you expect from a phone? Coming to the question, actually, so faster charging or a bigger, a higher MP camera? Only if it actually adds value. So faster charging we've spoken about. And of course, we also pointed to one of the YouTubers who had created a video in terms of what a faster charging could actually result in. So, you know, you can always look that up. Again, from a camera perspective, if it actually adds value, would be willing to look at it. But right now, I think from a POCO perspective, we have a very different point of view when it comes to, you know, any disruption that we're looking at in the mid segment.
True. Anuj, maybe just, I had one question for you from this. If you were to choose a 108 MP camera, do you think it is okay, or maybe a 108 or a 64 MP camera or a 48 MP camera, are you okay to kind of, you know, pick a not so good processor with these cameras?
No.
And why would the reason be?
I mean,
I just wanted to understand.
See, again, at least from my point of view, I cannot give up performance.
Okay.
Right. So the way you are talking in my head, and I'll go back to the car example that I keep giving.
Mm-hmm.
You are asking me, saying, you know, do I want a cassette player or a CD player or something with Bluetooth, or do I want a better engine in the car?
Car. Okay.
I will always choose the engine. Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, that's the most important thing. I'm using a car to kind of drive.
Product.
I'm using a phone. Mm. I want the maximum performance I can get out of that phone.
Got it.
In its class. I mean, I understand I will not be able to afford, you know, say a 40,000 or 50,000 phone. I might be looking at a budget, and I'm saying not personally, but
sure,
at a budget of say 20,000 rupees. Mm. At 20,000 rupees, what is the best performing phone I can get?
Yeah, understood.
Is very important to me.
Understood. And just an angle there as well, right? What would happen if the processor's ISP, let's just focus on the ISP part. Like, there are from every class, right? Snapdragon 600 series, 700 series, 800 series, and similarly on the MediaTek side. Is it important to have a very good ISP with a very good, you know, or a high megapixel camera, or you're okay if...
You do need that. I mean, otherwise, again, there's going to be a bottleneck, right?
Mm.
You have a big sensor that is putting in a lot of information.
Mm.
Now, A, you know, obviously depends on whether that sensor is actually good or not, but I'll put that aside. Say you are getting 48 million pixels,
True.
Or 64 million pixels, or 108 million pixels. But at the back end, if you don't have the image signal processing that can actually use it, then that's going to be wasted.
True. Right? Got it. Understood. So, folks, it's not just, I mean, if I have to kind of, you know, rephrase what Anuj is saying, right? It's not just enough to have a high megapixel camera. Even your ISP on the processor, not talking about the CPU, but the ISP, should be good enough to handle it. Fair enough, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Continuing, Dapman Rani, can I install a Google camera in my POCO X3? Oh, wow.
Let me see. Oh, yes, you can. frankly, I still think that the stock camera turns out some really good images. I've kept the Google Cam there just out of habit. I've been using Gcam on phones since, I think, 2018. So it's there when I was moving phones. Mm. But I tend to go mostly to the base stock camera that comes with the phone because it's been optimized for this particular phone.
Yeah. The next question is from Atharv. Will Poco F1 continue to receive the updates for the new customizations for MIUI for Poco? Because it is from the flagship series and that's why I have purchased it in February. Great specs, great camera, truly defines everything you want, nothing you don't. Just love the Poco series. Well, thank you so much.
Hey, I mean, F1 was absolutely brilliant. Obviously, I mean, that's why I keep getting questions and you have two kinds. yeah, I mean, do you have any updates on...
So, updates, folks, it's already been quite a while. We will definitely try to give you as much updates as possible. We have not thought after MIUI 12 as of now. If there is any further update, we will keep you posted.
In fact, you know, talking about updates and Poco F1, I think Poco F1 was the first phone in the world that enabled Widevine L1 through an OTA update.
True. That was a story in itself. Got it. The next question is from Ashish Vadekar, a big fan of Poco. So he has four questions. The first question is, why still give a 10-watt charger and a 5000 milliamp hour battery in Poco C3? Why not 33-watt and 6000 milliamp hour battery?
Okay.
So maybe we'll just go
take one by one?
One by one, yeah.
Okay. So it's simply a question of what people use at a particular price band, right? What we would do is, if we do a 33-watt charger and a specialized, I mean, I'm assuming that, you know, you're talking about the 6000 mAh battery, which is there on, say, X3, and put that in there as well. It'll add cost.
True.
And say if you can get the Poco C3 at 799, now you will be looking at a starting price of 899, 999, and you're loading everyone with that 1000 rupees extra, where only a very few people will actually use it. Right? Most people in this price class will be charging their phones throughout the night. Right, so they're not looking at fast charging, they're not looking at anything on those lines. Of course, from a battery perspective, 6000 can be done, but again, the question was how much is required and can it get past a full day, because they will inevitably kind of put it for charge at the night. So it's essentially 1.5 to 2 days, but that's obviously the buffer time that you get. Most people that we've realized are charging it throughout the night, so it's charging for like 5 to 7 hours easily. So unnecessary requirement. So, you know, again, you don't really want to dump everything onto a phone just to get some cool marketing call outs. Sometimes you have to look at the user pattern as well.
The next question is, why front camera does not have LED flash?
I'm pretty bad at selfies, so it didn't really matter to me at all. So front LED cameras came in for a very small time, I think 2017, where, you know, everyone was going, I mean, I think the only innovation for some time used to be selfie.
True.
Why you don't have them now is, one, selfie cameras themselves have improved, right? So through pixel binning and all that, they can take some really good pictures, even if the lighting conditions are low. And the second part is, you know, the overall space. Now, right in the front, you've got one small camera. Earlier, it used to be a 16:9, so you used to have this big bezels. So you can fit in, you know, five front cameras and six selfie flashes. Now, just putting one camera and then ensuring that there's not too much space wasted even around it is the technical challenge.
Yeah. The next question is, does Poco fan will get a review unit? Okay.
I mean, on Flipkart, you can always get a review in it.
Okay. The next question is, where should I give suggestions and help you to make more improving and great productive quality of Poco? Yes. I think pretty much he wants to give a lot of feedback.
So, okay. So this is an important one. And I think, you know, we are obviously working on developing Poco's own website. you should see Poco.in. There we will put in the community page pretty soon, so that you know we can obviously interact on a regular basis, not just once a week when we come on the AMAs, but also gather feedback at a user level, at a phone level, and things like that. So we'll have a community tab there pretty soon.
The next question is from Kushal. If we shift from Redmi phone to Poco, then in Poco we use the same Mi account only? So do we only use Mi account? The answer is yes.
So essentially we are using MIUI as the base. So hence it just makes sense. It's almost like, you know, between all the Android phones, you're still using your Gmail ID. So it's just one number.
The next one is, Anuj sir, you shifted from Mi company to Poco company, right? So not working for Mi anymore. Are you working for Mi, Anuj?
Okay. This is not related to the login, right?
No, not related to.
Because on the phone, I'm still using the Mi ID. But yes, I am now part of Poco.
The next question is from Preetam. Congrats for the success of Poco X3. Please pick my questions because they are interesting.
Okay.
Okay. How many members are present in your small team?
I think 9.
That's the India team, yeah, but yeah, that's 9.
So 9 here, but of course, from a back-end perspective, R&D and product development and all that, that becomes a little bigger.
Next is, do you guys chat with other CEOs in the tech world? Yeah, we do. What is the one thing you wish to add or remove in Poco? Oh, this is a very interesting question. So I'll just repeat it.
Okay.
What is the one thing you wish to add or remove in Poco X3? We all know nothing is perfect.
Yeah.
Good duo Anuj and Mancho will miss the duo after 2020. Oh, okay. So let's take the question. The question is really, really interesting. And thanks for missing.
So one thing I could take off from the X3 and...
So you can add or remove. Your call. Your call.
Huh. Okay. You know, when you ask me to add, I will always add performance. So if I could put in more performance, I would be happier. Where I think I could probably live with is, you know, I mean, this has a 64 MP camera. I could do with a 48.
Okay.
Right. Frankly, most of the photographs that I do take are not in the 64 MP mode or not in the 48 MP mode. It's actually in the basic photo mode, which is using the entire sensor to capture pretty much like a 12 or a 16 MP.
True.
So I'm pretty happy with that. And obviously we've seen, you know, the Sony IMX 500 series also performed really well.
True.
But if I can put a higher performer there, which has a good ISP that we were talking about, that'll cover up for that. But when I'm not taking pictures, then I'm going to be, I mean, a faster phone is always a tick mark from my side. Yeah. What about you?
No, I'll definitely agree with you, right? I mean, just to make it very simple, right? If I were able to kind of, you know, put in a Snapdragon 845 or an 855, I would be happy. I would be extremely happy with that.
But that's not going to be anywhere in the price class. So.
Absolutely, absolutely. But yeah, that's how I would kind of, you know, think about it.
Yeah, but... Okay.
Cool. That's all, guys, from our side. See you next time soon. Bye.
Thank you.